Welcome to the Old Time Radio Hour. I'm your host, Justeen Ward, and each week we bring you a classic show from radio's golden age. In 1956, CBS revived the Columbia Workshop with a new name, CBS Radio Workshop. Producer William Froug knew there was demand for creative adult drama on radio, so he offered a series dedicated to man's imagination, The Theater of the Mind. The series was preserved in good quality on audio tape, and it's guaranteed to take your mind on a wonderful journey. First, we have two short stories by Ray Bradbury, with short commentary by Bradbury himself. And afterwards, we have an amazingly lively interview with William Shakespeare. Ray Bradbury explores the nature of time and nostalgia in two stories. This is CBS Radio Workshop, Season of Disbelief, and Hail and Farewell, first broadcast February 17th, 1956, on CBS.
CBS Radio, a division of the Columbia Broadcasting System and its 217 affiliated stations, present the CBS Radio Workshop, radio's distinguished series dedicated to man's imagination, the theater of the mind. Tonight, from Hollywood, Season of Disbelief and Hail and Farewell, adapted and directed by Anthony Ellis. Two unusual and provocative character studies by one of America's most original authors, Ray Bradbury. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bradbury.
It has always seemed to me that life, to all of us, is an endless coil of rope playing through our hands every moment of every hour of the day. The long line of the rope goes back to the time we were born and extends on out ahead to the time of our death. In between lies the eternal now, the flickering moments when each of us must play the rope as best we can, without burning our fingers, snarling the coils, or breaking the line. This is a study of one woman and her rope.
Season of Disbelief. Old Mrs. Bentley was a saver. She saved tickets, old theater programs, bits of lace, scarves, railroad transfers and such things. All the tags and tokens of her experience she saved.
I have a stack of records. Here's Caruso. It was in 1921 in New York. I was 40. John was still alive. Here's June Moon. 1929, I think, right after John died.
That was the huge regret of her life, in a way. The one thing she had most enjoyed touching and listening to and looking at, she hadn't saved. John was far out in the meadow country, dated and boxed and hidden under grasses. And nothing remained of him but his high silk hat, his cane, and his good suit in the closet. But what she could keep, she had kept. Pink flower dresses crushed among mothballs and vast black trunks, and cut glass dishes from her childhood. Her past lived with her. Then, the thing with the children. It happened in the middle of the summer. Mrs. Bentley, coming out to water the ivy on her front porch, saw the two cool-colored, sprawling girls lying on her green lawn, enjoying the immense prickling of the grass. At the very moment she was smiling down on them with her yellow mask face, around the corner, like an elfin band, came an ice cream wagon. The two girls sat up, turning their heads like sunflowers after the sun.
Little girls, would you like some?
The wagon stopped. There was an exchange of money for pieces of the original ice age. These she gave to the girls, who thanked her with snow in their mouths, their eyes darting from her buttoned-up shoes to her white hair.
Don't you want a bite?
No, no, child. I'm old enough and cold enough. The hottest day won't thaw me. Come up on the porch and sit in the shade. But mind you don't drip.
I'm Alice. She's Jane.
Oh, how nice. I'm Mrs. Bentley. They call me Helen.
I didn't know old ladies had first names.
Well, you never hear them used.
Oh, my dear, when you're as old as I, they won't call you Jane either. Old age is dreadfully formal.
How old are you?
I remember the dinosaur.
No, but how old?
75.
That's old.
I don't feel any different now than when I was your age.
Our age?
Yes, once I was a pretty little girl, just like you, Jane. What's the matter?
Nothing.
Oh, you don't have to go so soon, I hope.
Well.
Is something the matter? What?
My mother says it isn't nice to fib.
Of course it isn't.
And not to listen to fibs.
Who was fibbing to you, Alice?
You were.
About what?
About your age. About being a little girl.
But I was. Many years ago, a little girl like you.
Come on, Jane.
But how ridiculous. It's perfectly obvious. Everyone was young once.
You're joking with us. You weren't really 10 ever, were you, Mrs. Bentley?
You run on home. Get away from here. I won't have you laughing.
And your name's not really Helen.
Of course it's Helen.
Goodbye.
Thanks for the ice cream.
Once I played hopscotch. You hear me? I did. The idea. No one ever doubted I was a girl before. What a silly, horrible thing to do. I don't mind being old. Not really. But I do resent having my childhood taken away from me.
After supper, she gathered together certain items in a perfumed kerchief. Then she went to her front porch and stood there stiffly for half an hour. As suddenly as night birds, the two girls flew by, and Mrs. Bentley's voice brought them to a fluttering rest.
Girls! Girls!
Yes, Mrs. Bentley?
Come up on the porch.
Yes, Mrs. Bentley?
I've got some treasures to show you. Sit down, both of you. Now, here. I wore this when I was 9.
It's a comb.
Let's see. Oh, it's pretty.
And here's a tiny ring I wore when I was 8. It doesn't fit my finger now.
Why, it just fits me.
The comb fits my hand.
And here, a picture.
Who's this little girl?
It's me.
Oh, it doesn't look like you.
Anybody could get a picture like this somewhere.
But it's the truth.
Any more pictures, Mrs. Bentley? Of you later? You got a picture of you at 15? And one at 20? Oh. One at 40? 50?
Oh, nonsense. I don't have to show you anything.
And we don't have to believe you.
But this picture proves I was young.
That's some other little girl like us. You borrowed it.
I was married.
Where's Mr. Bentley?
He's been gone a long time. If he were here, he'd tell you how young and pretty I was when I was 22.
But he's not here, and he can't tell.
I have a marriage certificate.
You could have borrowed it.
The only way I'll believe you were ever young is if you have someone say they saw you when you were 10.
Thousands of people saw me, but they're dead, you little fool. Dead or ill, or gone away in other towns. I don't know a soul here. Just moved here a few years ago, so no one saw me young.
Well, there you are. Nobody saw her.
Listen, you must take these things on faith. Someday you'll be as old as I. People will say the same. Oh, no. They'll say those vultures were never hummingbirds. Those owls were never orioles. Those parrots were never bluebirds. One day you'll be like me.
No, I won't.
Or me.
You wait and see. You, child, your mother. Haven't you noticed over the years the change?
No, she's always the same.
I guess we'd better go home. Thanks for the comb, it's fine.
And thanks for the ring. It just fits. And the picture, the little girl.
No, come back. You can't have those. They're mine.
No, you stole them. They belong to some little girl. You stole them.
No! Come back! Oh, come back!
lay awake for many hours into that night, among her trunks and trinkets. A night wind blew in the room. The white curtain fluttered against a dark cane, which had leaned against that wall near the other bric-a-brac for many years. The cane trembled and fell. Its gold ferrule glittered in the moonlight. It was her husband's opera cane. It seemed as if he were pointing it at her, as he often had, using his soft, sad, reasonable voice.
Those children are right. They stole nothing from you, my dear. These things don't belong to you here, you, now. They belong to her, that other you, so long ago.
And then, as though an ancient phonograph record had been set hissing under a steel needle, she remembered a conversation she had once with Mr. Bentley. Mr. Bentley, so prim, a pink carnation in his whisk-broomed lapel.
My dear, you never will understand time, will you? Don't you see, no matter how hard you try to be what you once were, you can only be what you are here and now. Time plays tricks. When you're 9, you think you've always been 9 years old and will always be. When you're 30, it seems you've always been balanced there on that bright rim of middle life. And then, when you become 70, you are always and forever 70. You are in the present. You are trapped in a young now or an old now. But there is no other now to be seen. Ticket stubs are trickery. Saving things is a magic trick with mirrors. You're saving cocoons, corsets in a way you can never fit again. Why save them? You can't really prove you were ever young.
Pictures. Pictures, John.
No, they lie. You're not the picture.
After the
No, picture. You're not the dates or the ink or the paper. You're not these trunks of junk and tricks. You're only here now, the present you.
Yes, I see. In the morning, I'll do something final about this and settle down to being only me and nobody else for many other year. That's what I'll do.
The morning was bright and green, and there at her door, like moths bumping softly on the screen, were the two girls.
Got any more things to give us, Mrs. Bentley? More of the little girls' things?
She led them down the hall to the library.
Take this.
The dress in which she had played the mandarin's daughter at 15.
And this.
A kaleidoscope, a magnifying glass.
Pick out anything you want. Books, skates, dolls, everything. They're yours.
Ours?
Only yours. And will you help me with a little work? I'm building a big fire in my backyard. I'm emptying the trunks, throwing out this trash for the trash man. It doesn't belong to me. Nothing ever belongs to anybody.
We'll help you, Mrs. Bentley. It'll be fun.
And now, on summer afternoons, you can see the two little girls like wrens on a wire on Mrs. Bentley's front porch. They sit in their cool dresses, not stirring, waiting for her. And when the silvery chimes of the ice cream man are heard, the front door opens, Mrs. Bentley floats out with her hand deep in the throat of her silver-mouthed purse, and for half an hour you can see them there on the porch, the two girls and the old lady, putting coldness into warmness, eating chocolate icicles, laughing. At last, they are good friends.
How old are you, Mrs. Bentley?
75.
How old were you 50 years ago?
75.
You were never young, were you? And never wore ribbons or dresses like these?
No, Jane. Never.
Have you got a first name?
My name is Mrs. Bentley.
And you've always lived in this one house?
Always.
And never were pretty.
Never.
Never in a million trillion years.
Never in a million trillion years.
Presenting now the second of our duo, and Mr. Ray Bradbury.
The rope of life hisses through our fingers. We reach, it's gone. The beauty of any particular flower, song, poem, or person lies often in the fact that roses must fade, songs die with the breath, poems burn in the fire. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust. But what if beauty could be made to last? Would it still be beautiful or monstrous? Here is the study of a person who seized the traveling rope of life, a moment of beauty, and felt it freeze in his hands.
Hail and farewell.
Going away. There was nothing else to do. The time was up, the clock had run out, and he was going very far away indeed. His suitcase was packed, shoes shined, hair brushed, it expressly washed behind his ears, and it remained only for him to go down the stairs, out the front door, and up the street to the small town station where the train would make a stop for him alone. Then Fox Hill, Illinois, would be left far off in his past. And he would go on, perhaps to Iowa, perhaps to Kansas, perhaps even to California.
Willie?
Yes?
Almost time.
All right. I'll be down.
In the mirror on his dresser, he saw a face made of June dandelions and July apples and warm summer morning milk. There, as always, was his look of the angel and the innocent, which might never in the years of his life change. Picked up his valise, looked once more around his room, and went downstairs.
Here I am.
You can't really be leaving us, Willie.
People are beginning to talk. I've been here 3 years now, but when people begin to talk, I know it's time to put on my shoes and buy a railroad ticket.
It's all so strange. I just don't understand. It's so sudden. We'll miss you, Willie. We'll miss you very much.
I'll write you every Christmas.
It's been a great pleasure and satisfaction. It's a shame it had to stop. Shame that you had to tell us about yourself. An awful shame you can't stay on.
You're the nicest folks I ever had.
Oh, Willie. Willie.
It's not easy to go. You get used to things. You want to stay. But it doesn't work. I tried to stay on once after people began to suspect. How horrible, people said. All these years playing with our innocent children, they said. And us not guessing. Awful. And I finally had to leave town one night. It's not easy. You know darn well how much I love both of you. Thanks for 3 swell years. Well...
Willie, where will you go?
I don't know. I just start traveling. When I see a town that looks nice and green, I settle in.
Will you ever come back?
Oh, in about 20 years, maybe it should begin to show on my face. When it does, I'm going to make a grand tour of all the mothers and fathers I've had.
Oh, Willie.
We can't complain, Anna. Better to have had a son... 36 months than none whatever.
Well, I guess it's time. Goodbye.
Thanks.
Willie kissed Anna quickly, touched Steve's hand, seized his luggage, and was gone up the street in the green noon light under the trees, not looking back. A small boy, 12 years old, with a birth certificate in his valise to show that he had been born 43 years ago. Boys were playing on the Green Park Diamond when he came by. He stood a little while among the oak tree shadows, watching them hurl the white, snowy baseball into the warm summer air. The boys' voices yelled, and the ball lit on the path near Willie.
Hey, Willie! Where are you going, Willie?
Gonna visit a cousin of mine for a few days.
Huh?
You guys just throwing the ball around, huh?
Yeah. You taking the train alone, Willie?
Yeah.
Boy, that's neat.
Hey, how about a couple of throws? I got a little time.
Sure, I guess so.
Willie dropped his bag and ran back. The white baseball was already up in the sun and plunging down to him. And away again to their white figures, up in the sun again, rushing, life coming and going in a pattern. He thought of the last 3 years, now spent to the penny, and the 5 years before that, and so on down the line. The baseball flying here, there. Mr. and Mrs. Robert Hanlon, Creek Bend, Wisconsin, 1932, the first couple, the first year. Henry and Alice Bolts, Lineville, Iowa, 1935. The Smiths, the Eatons, Robinsons, 1939, 1945. Husband and wife, husband and wife. No children, no children, no children. A knock on this door, a knock on that.
Pardon me. My name is William. I wonder if I could...
A sandwich? Come in. Come in and sit down. Where are you from, son?
The sandwich, tall glass of cold milk, the smiling, the nodding, the comfortable, leisurely talking.
Well, son, you look like you've been traveling. You run off from somewhere.
No.
Are you an orphan?
We always wanted kids. Never worked out. Never knew why, one of those things. Well, getting late, son. Don't you think you better hit for home?
I got no home.
A boy like you? Not dry behind the ears? Your mother'll get worried.
I got no home and no folks anywhere in the world. I wonder... Could I sleep here tonight?
Well, now, son, I don't just know. We never considered taking in a...
We've got chicken for supper tonight. Enough for extras. Enough for company.
The voices and the faces and the people and always the same first conversations. The years turning, flying away. The voice of Emily Robinson in a rocking chair in summer night darkness. The last night he stayed with her. The night she discovered his secret. Her voice saying,
I look at all the little children's faces going by, and I sometimes think, what a shame. What a shame that all these flowers have to be cut. All these bright fires have to be put out. What a shame all these have to get tall and unsightly and wrinkle and turn gray or get bald and finally all bone and wheeze be dead and buried off away. When I hear them laugh, I can't believe they'll ever go the road I'm going. They're so eager for everything. I guess that's what I miss most in older folks. The eagerness gone, 9 times out of 10. The freshness gone. So much of the drive and life down the drain. I like to watch school let out each day. It's like someone threw a bunch of flowers out of the school front doors. How does it feel, Willie? How does it feel to be young forever? Are you happy? Are you as fine as you seem?
I worked with what I had. After my folks died, after I found I couldn't get man's work anywhere,
I tried carnivals, but they only laughed. Son, they said, you're not a midget. And even if you are, you look like a boy. We want midgets with midgets' faces. Sorry, son. What was I? A boy? I looked like a boy, sounded like a boy. So I might as well go on being a boy. What could I do? What job was there for me? And then one day I saw this man in a restaurant looking at another man's pictures of his kids. Sure wish I had kids, he said. Sure wish I had kids. And that instant, sitting there, I knew what my job would be for all the rest of my life. There was work for me, making lonely people happy, keeping myself busy, playing forever. I knew I had to play forever, deliver a few papers, run a few errands, mow a few lawns. All I had to do was to be a mother's son and a father's pride.
But, Willie, didn't you ever get lonely? Didn't you want things that grown-ups wanted?
I fought that out alone. I'm a boy, I told myself. I'll have to live in a boy's world, read boys' books, play boys' games, cut myself off from everything else. And I played it that way. Oh, it wasn't easy. There were times.
But it's nice being a child for over 40 years.
It's a living, as they say. And when you make other people happy, then you're almost happy, too. And anyway, in a few years now, I'll be in my second childhood. All the fevers will be out of me and all the unfulfilled things. And most of the dreams. Then I can relax.
He threw the baseball one last time and broke the reverie. Then he was picking up his suitcase. The two boys stood beside him. They were embarrassed at his shaking hands with him.
Oh, Willie. Means if you're going to China or something.
Oh, that's right. It isn't.
So long, Willie. See you next week.
Yeah. So long, Sam. So long, Jamie.
And he was walking off with his suitcase again, looking at the trees, going away from the boys and the street where he had lived. And as he turned the corner, a train whistle screamed and he began to run. In the early morning, with the iron smell of the train around him and a full night of traveling shaking his bones and his body, he awoke and looked out on a small town just arising from sleep. A porter moved by, a shadow in the shadows.
Sir, what town's this?
Valleyville.
How many people?
10,000. Why, this your stop?
It looks green. It looks nice and quiet.
Son, you know where you're going?
Here.
I hope you know what you're doing, boy.
Yes, sir. I know what I'm doing.
Down the dark aisle, luggage lifted after him by the porter, and out into the smoking, steaming cold beginning to lighten morning. He stood looking at the porter in the black metal train against the few remaining stars.
Boy!
Wish me luck!
What?
Wish me luck!
Oh, best of luck, son. Best of luck to you, boy.
Thanks!
He watched the black train. He didn't move all the time it was going. He stood quietly. A small boy, 12 years old again, on the worn wooden platform, and only after 3 entire minutes until the train was completely gone away and out of sight did he turn at last to face the empty streets below. Then, as the sun was rising, he began to walk very fast so as to keep warm down into the new town.
Tonight, the CBS Radio Workshop has presented two studies by Ray Bradbury, adapted and directed by Anthony Ellis. The first, Season of Disbelief, with Virginia Gregg and John Daner, Dawn Bender, Marion Richmond, and Herb Butterfield. The second, Hail and Farewell, with Richard Beals, Stacey Harris, Vivi Janis, Lawrence Dopkin, Paula Winslow, Roy Glenn, Billy Chapin, and Peggy Weber. We wish to thank Mr. Bradbury for being our special guest. Original music for tonight's program was composed and conducted by Jerry Goldsmith. The CBS Radio Workshop is produced by William Froug. This is Hugh Douglas inviting you to join us again next week when we present the eminent Shakespearean teacher, Dr. Frank C. Baxter, professor of English at the University of Southern California, and Mr. William Shakespeare, noted author, who will be our special guests, presented on the CBS Radio Workshop. On Sunday, over most of these same stations, the New York Philharmonic Symphony will be heard in another exciting concert conducted by Dmitri Metropolis. This weekend, the noted Polish pianist, Witold Małkuczynski, will be heard as soloist. Stay tuned for 5 minutes of CBS News, to be followed on most of these stations by The Jack Carson Show. America listens most to the CBS Radio Network.
You are listening to the Old Time Radio Hour, broadcast each week over the World Wide Web with your host, Justeen Ward. Next, we have a delightfully chaotic interview with William Shakespeare, with appearances by various well-acted historical figures who claim to have written the plays themselves. Acting as host and ringmaster is Frank Baxter, professor of English at USC. You will love the creative way that Shakespeare's words are woven into the interview. Enjoy CBS Radio Workshop, an interview with Shakespeare. First broadcast February 24th, 1956 on CBS.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Frank C. Baxter.
Who steals my purse steals trash, but he that filches from me my good name robs me of that which not enriches him and makes me poor indeed. William Shakespeare said that.
CBS Radio, a division of the Columbia Broadcasting System and its 217 affiliated stations, present the CBS Radio Workshop, dedicated to man's imagination, the theater of the mind. Tonight, transcribed, the workshop presents its first colloquy, featuring the eminent teacher of Shakespeare, Dr. Frank C. Baxter, professor of English at the University of Southern California, who in turn will introduce his special guest, Dr. Baxter.
Thank you and good evening. For some time now, many of us have been fascinated by a controversy unique in the annals of literature. Stated simply, the question is, who wrote the works of William Shakespeare? Articles have been carried in our most popular magazines. Eminent scholars have debated and debunked. Almost everybody has a theory. So, in the interest of true scientific research, in an effort to settle this knotty problem once and for all, we have invited as our special guest tonight the distinguished author, Mr. William Shakespeare.
How do you do?
I trust you had a pleasant journey, Mr. Shakespeare?
Aye, and with more comfort and in less time than once it took to fork a palfrey from Stratford up to London. A half a day from Old England to the brave New World. The time, to be sure, is out of joint, sir.
Yes, time travels in divers paces with divers persons. That's an As You Like It, Act 3, Scene 2.
Yes, I know.
Well, Will, if I may call you Will?
Will it as you will.
Thank you. Will, there have, from time to time, been questions raised as to whether you actually wrote the plays and poems which bear your name.
No, it is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Well, be that as it may, that's why we've asked you to be with us tonight, to shed some light on this clouded controversy.
I shall be glad to help, though in truth the matter galls me.
As indeed it well might.
Believe me, it is no flattering unction to my soul. Have you the slightest notion how many candidates have been nominated to fill my buskins?
Well, there's Sir Francis Bacon, of course, and Edward Dyer, and the Earl of Oxford.
And three more earls, Southampton, Rutland, and Derby. Then there's Sir Walter Raleigh.
There was even a woman, I believe.
Oh, spare the mark, the delicate Countess of Pembroke. And don't forget my contemporary scriveners, Decker, Haywood, Webster, Peel, Nash.
How do you account for such confusion of claims, Will?
There were no such things as copyrights in my day. A writer was commissioned by a company of players to write a play. He did so, he was paid for it, and that was the end of it.
Well, how much was he paid?
Well, that would depend. £6, £7, £8. £10 was most generous, about $500 in your money.
$500 seems very little for all the rights to a play.
It was, and therefore a writer had to do other things to eke out a living. I myself was an actor, as well as a shareholder in the company.
Your company was called the Kingsmen, wasn't it?
Yes. You see, it was absolutely necessary in those days for an acting company to be patronized by a nobleman or a member of royalty.
Why was that?
Well, if he were not so sponsored, the law demanded that the lobe of his right ear be pierced by a red-hot iron of the circumference of an inch.
Well,
Apparently, it wasn't exactly respectable to be an actor in your time.
Is it in yours?
Well, even today, we find it better to have a sponsor.
Exactly. As members of the King's Company, we enjoyed many privileges not granted to less eminent groups. But with these privileges went the obligation to maintain our eminence, to please not only the court, but the crowd. In other words, we had to produce hits, and almost every day, a different play.
I see. You didn't then know the luxury of long runs.
Oh, indeed not. Our public was as fickle as it was avid. Therefore, our theater was voracious, a gluttonous maw into which we crammed play after play.
Somewhat like our movies today, or our radio, television.
Well, somewhat. Certainly the audiences gave not a fig for high passion. They clamored for clowns and loved the lewd and bawdy line. Do you think Richard or Henry V or the Merchant of Venice were enough to fill the bellies and pay the lodgings of my company? Indeed not, sir. We knew the sheriff as well as many a theatrical company that came after us. Else why do you think that I wrote those banal vulgarities?
Banal vulgarities? The plays? Which do you mean, for instance?
Why, Much Ado About Nothing, which indeed is all it was. And As You Like It, which is to say, not as I liked it.
But, Will, these are still among the most often performed of all your works.
Need I argue further proof?
No, but they still play your other works, too. Will, this week, for instance, Romeo and Juliet, Kiss Me, Kate, are being revived in New York.
Kiss Me, Kate? 'Tis no play of mine.
Oh, yes, it is. You called it The Taming of the Shrew.
Then why was its title changed?
Oh, they fixed it up and set it to music.
Oh, perfidy.
It makes money, Will.
Oh.
Was theater attendance good in your day?
Not bad, when you consider that 2 out of 15 Londoners attended the theater every week. And there were no less than 100 poets and playwrights writing words that you still read today.
That's remarkable. But, Will, were you really one of those 100 playwrights and poets?
Why, of course I was. My 2 long poems, Venus and Adonis, and The Rape of Lucrece, attest to it. To say nothing of the 154 sonnets. I was indeed, sir, a poet.
A poet. But the plays. Your name is known today chiefly for the plays.
The plays. Oh, poor foundlings. Conceived in need and born in the desperate rush to feed the insatiable appetite of the sweating mob. A manuscript dashed off by candlelight. Its parts extracted by a scribe, and the only copies serving the prompters as long as the play pleased the crowd.
What happened to the manuscript after that?
Ah, who knows? Perhaps it remained in the theater, or found its way to an actor's trunk, marked and smudged with the arrogant changes of 12 performances. Perhaps it was sold for waste to a butcher or a fishmonger to wrap up a slice of veal or an evening kipper. The playwright neither knew nor cared. He was, if that strumpet fortune smiled upon him again, working on his next play.
But this seems incredible. These great plays.
Oh, good Dr. Baxter. Have you a copy of all the scripts that you have ever broadcast? Or even yet a copy of every lecture you have made?
Well, I see what you mean.
Who knows how many plays were reduced to black and ash the afternoon the Globe Theater went up in flames. Not I, for one.
As I remember, it was during a performance of your Henry VIII that the Globe caught fire.
Aye. Some varlet boy, tending the cannon that heralded the entrance of the king, let flame and powder o'erreach themselves. And ere night fell, the Globe, my theater, was a stinking mass of smoking ashes. 12 years of my life were in the Globe. Across its boards first trod Hamlet. Othello, Lear, Macbeth. It was the birthplace of Julius Caesar and Cleopatra's cradle. The date was consumed in fire. The theater having quit me, I quit the theater. I never wrote another play, sir.
Another? Did you ever write one, Will of Stratford?
I beg your pardon, sir. Who are you?
'Tis Kit Marlowe, most recent of the thieves who seek to steal my name.
Christopher Marlowe? The Marlowe who wrote Tamburlaine and Dr. Faustus and the Jew of Malta?
Nice, Marlowe of the mighty line. I've been listening to this drivel on the wireless in yon tavern till my gut could stand no more. This impostor, this clown must be answered, and I'm here to demand equal time to that which you've granted the poet ape of Stratford. Equal time, mark you, I believe that is the custom with your modern theater of electronic witchcraft.
Indeed, sir, it is. Come in. Welcome. Our time is your time, or at least part of it.
You understand, good sir, I can no longer stand silent whilst this unlettered bumpkin, this supporting player, palms himself off as the brightest jewel to grace the crown of England's Renaissance.
Then it was you, Christopher Marlowe, who wrote the plays of William Shakespeare.
Who else?
I thought you were murdered in a tavern brawl in the very year that Will Shakespeare published his Venus and Adonis, the year of Richard III and the Comedy of Errors.
Good professor, not you too. Murdered, I? You've let your reading slip while overmuch you've taught your classes. There were reasons enough why I should disappear. Reasons which yet I dare not fully tell. But murdered, not I, it was another.
A likely tale.
Likelier than the monstrous myth that a countryman, unschooled and uneducated, could have written the works which bear the name of Shakespeare.
'Tis true you will not find my plays as scholarly as yours, Kid Marlowe. 'Tis true I knew little Latin and less Greek. I was better acquainted with people than I was with books.
Oh?
Master Marlowe, since you insist that history lies in telling us that you were murdered at the age of 29, perhaps you'd be good enough to tell us what did happen to you.
That I will, sir, and gladly. My friend, Sir Thomas Walsingham...
Oh, that one.
Arranged the deception. Having had some unknown and worthless varlet murdered, he gave forth the word 'twas I who died. Then all secured, I made my way to France, and thence south to Italy, where I learned the manners and the customs of those distant lands, where, incidentally, I gathered background material for Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, what a lying rogue and peasant slave is he.
I wrote that, yes. And other comedies and tragedies which I produced under the name of an obscure actor called William Shakespeare.
But why use my name?
Well, mine I could not use, being still suspect and with a price upon my head. Wanted, I believe, is the current phrase. So why not your name, since you were nothing, nobody, zero?
Then why did you not attribute your own Tamburlaine the Great to me?
Well, really?
Now that it has flopped so dismally on Broadway.
The Saturday Review called it a piece of classic theater. I have the notices. There.
Yes, they look excellent. Master Marlowe, yours is the latest name to enter the list of claimants for the works that we know as Shakespeare's. Perhaps you'd like to take this opportunity to substantiate that claim.
Indeed I would, sir. That is, in fact, why I'm here. Therefore, hark ye. In Edward II, under my own name, I wrote, "Weep not for Mortimer that scorns the world and as a traveler goes to discover countries yet unknown." And then I wrote Hamlet, using the name of Shakespeare, in which you'll find these words, "The undiscovered country from whose bourn no traveler returns." You notice the similarity?
Not exactly.
Discover, undiscover, very like.
Nevertheless, Master Marlowe's claim is seriously presented, the result of years of somebody's thought.
That indeed it is, sir, but to pursue the point. Note again in Edward II the line, "How now, why droops the earl?" And as Shakespeare in Henry IV, part 2, "Why droops me lord like overripened corn?"
At least you had learned to make a simile when next you stole from yourself.
Once more, in Edward II, I say, "I arrest you of high treason." And using Shakespeare's name in Henry VIII, I wrote, "I arrest thee of high treason."
But if you must arrest a man of high treason, is there a simpler way of saying it? Though it is clear that my way is more graceful.
No, I could go on.
And onward he will go, unless somewhat stopped by lack of breath or the roving eye of a passing wench. Is there no way, good Dr. Baxter, to bring an end to it?
Not an end, but the middle. For here, as is the custom in our CBS Radio Workshop colloquy, we pause for a short announcement.
You are listening to Colloquy 1, the first in a series of discussion programs to be presented from time to time as part of the CBS Radio Workshop. This evening, our special guest is Dr. Frank C. Baxter, professor of English at the University of Southern California, who is interviewing the noted author, William Shakespeare. Once again, here is Dr. Baxter.
And we have an unexpected but very provocative guest, Christopher Marlowe, the great Elizabethan playwright and the most recent of a score of Shakespeare's contemporaries who claim to have written his works.
Well, can there be any rational argument against such overwhelming proof?
I would not deign to dignify such syllogistic sophistry.
Oh, your pardon, sirs.
Yes? Were you looking for someone?
I'm told by the warders of your gate that somewhere within a colloquy is being held. Is this the place?
Well, it is, but I'm...
Then permit me. I am Edward de Vere, 17th Earl of Oxford. And you, sir?
I am the first Francis Baxter of South Pasadena at your service, my lord.
Oh, we are well met, sir. Will Shakespeare.
Your lordship's looking well. Indeed, somewhat better than when we last met.
If I recall, it was at the Globe in the spring of 1604, and you were playing, as was your wont, the ghost of Hamlet's father.
Indeed I was. Though I must confess your lordship picked a bad day to see the play.
I was way off that afternoon.
Oh, tut, tut, goodbye, man. You played it well as I intended it should be played when I wrote it.
You wrote it?
I don't believe that I've had the honor.
Oh, pardon me, Your Lordship. May I present Christopher Marlowe?
Ah, yes, Marlowe. Informer, spy, pederast, and sometimes scrivener.
Have it, the ruling aristo, sycophant, spineless ornament of a dickhead.
Wait, gentlemen, fellow, have you
it is easy to see why Marlowe's mighty line was ended so early and so violently.
I demand this ignorant valley be removed.
Ignorant! I graced the halls of Cambridge more brilliantly than ever you, the university which bears your name.
My name,
sir. School ties, the current phrase, is it
yes,
not?
Approximately. Let's call it school spirit.
Done, sir.
Sir, Master Marlowe has as much right here as you. These days, we make much of a man's right to speak his mind without fear or reprisal.
Of what use, then, the stock, the rack, and the pillory?
None any longer. Ours is an enlightened age.
And so was ours. But we had ways to curb the vagrant tongues of churls.
Well, we found out that if we let them wag their vagrant tongues long enough, they end by hanging themselves.
It is passing strange, what?
So, my lord, you've come here to present your case.
In all truth, it would be beneath me to plead a case for writings tossed off in a moment of whim and consumed with eagerness beyond credulity by a tasteless public. Were it not for an American gentleman who discovered my secret, I would not be here. But since he has gone to such length to prove the truth I know so well, I feel it only fair to him to present here the arguments he has advanced in my favor, and thus set injustice right, and prevent either a brawling tippler or an Avonian peasant from claiming what is my due.
Your due.
An American gentleman, you say?
Oh, yes, yes. It was he who more than 30 years ago revealed in a book called Shakespeare Identified that it was I, Edward de Vere, 17th Earl of Oxford, who was indeed the author of the works which, for nearly 400 years, have been attributed to this strolling player, yclept Shakespeare.
And how was this American gentleman yclept?
Looney was his name, J. Thomas Looney.
Did you say Looney?
I did, sirrah. L-O-O-N-E-Y, Looney.
That's what I thought you said.
And how did Mr. Looney arrive at his conclusions?
Oh, by deduction. He decided that Shakespeare's works could only have been written by a mature man of recognized genius. An unconventional man not adequately appreciated. A lyric poet of recognized talent. A man of superior classical education. And finally, an aristocrat. A gentleman. Whose image fits within this frame? Whose? But mine.
But surely, surely, sir. Surely there were others in London at the time who could meet these specifications?
Perhaps. But remember Mr. Looney's insistence that his man be a lyric poet of recognized talent.
And you were such a one?
Oh, good master. And you call yourself professor of English literature? Wist ye not this jewel? If women be fair and yet be fond, or that their love were firm and fickle, still I would not marvel that they make men bond. By service long to purchase their goodwill, but when I see how frail those creatures are, I muse that men forget themselves so far. What say ye to that, sir?
Very pretty indeed.
For my own part, it was Greek to me.
The subject, women? Aye, there's a topic to task a poet's muse, a worthy topic, a palate for passion, a right and proper challenge for Marlowe's mighty line. Hark, here's a woman for you, lads. Was this the face that launched a thousand ships and burnt the topless towers of Ilium? Sweet Helen, make me immortal with a kiss. Her lips suck forth my soul. See where it flies. Come, Helen, come give me my soul again. Here will I dwell, for heaven be in these lips, and all is dross that is not Helena, and none but thou shall be my paramour.
Dross, indeed. You quote yourself very well, Master Marlowe.
No, it offends me to the soul to hear a robustious, periwig-pated fellow tear a passion to tatters, to very rags. With presumption, you may lay claim to my work, but in all assurance, I would never put my name on yours.
Master Will.
You speak of love. Oxford with cynical doubt, Marlowe with froward lechery. Bear with me, gentles. Let me not to the marriage of true minds admit impediments. Love is not love which alters when it alteration finds, or bends with the remover to remove. Oh, no. It is an ever-fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. It is a star to every wandering bark whose worth's unknown, although his height be taken. Love's not time's fool, though rosy lips and cheeks within his bending sickle's compass come. Love alters not with his brief hours and weeks, but bears it out even to the edge of doom. If this be error and upon me proved, I never writ, nor no man ever loved.
Ah, oh, it is one of my favorites, and has been since the day I wrote it.
Good, Dr. Baxter, let us be done and finished. I care not what others such as these may say. I know who wrote the works of Shakespeare.
And who might that be? Sir Francis Bacon?
A lawyer. The most unkindest cut of all.
No matter what he might have been, the Viscount St. Albans was not a poet.
No, never claimed to be.
Oh, Bacon, the Lord Verulam, not above eavesdropping.
I had been content to stay without this colloquy, had not my name been mentioned.
Ah, you started the tongues to wagging. You let loose the dogs of rumor, my Lord High Chancellor.
Not I, gentle Will. I lay no pretensions to any man's works save my own.
No, Will, you really do Sir Francis an injustice. Just as an American presented the Earl of Oxford, and more recently another American put forth Kit Marlowe, so it was an American lady 100 years ago who proposed that Sir Francis was the moving spirit behind your works, and her name was Miss Delia Bacon.
No relative of mine, let the record show.
The record so shows. Don't you remember, Will, how she used to spend nightly vigils on your tomb?
100 years ago? Ah, yes. Slow memory knits the raveled sleeve of time. A most disturbing woman. More ghosts than I.
Yes, after she published her book, The Philosophy of Shakespeare's Plays Unfolded, she requested permission of the mayor of Stratford to open your tomb.
Is there no peace? Everybody wants to open a tomb.
But the mayor refused, and perhaps because of it, shortly afterward, she became quite mad, died in a lunatic asylum.
Where all who doubt me belong in truth, sir.
Oh, now wait, just a minute, Will. A man named George Townsend, a staunch supporter of yours, who wrote an answer to Miss Bacon's book, also became mad and committed suicide.
And you asked me, who's loony?
The Baconians have flourished ever since. They claim to have found cryptograms in the Shakespeare texts which prove your authorship, Sir Francis.
Indeed, well.
They form societies and publish papers. They're quite sincere, almost fanatical about you. Some claim that you live to be 107. And there are extremists who insist that you still live today in some pleasant English country house, writing immortal works which someday will be revealed to us.
I must aver that I am indeed dead, quite dead, and have been these past 330 years. In fact, I caught my death of cold collecting snow with which I intended to stuff a fowl.
Why, pray?
I was a scientist, to test the effectiveness of cold in the preservation of organic substances.
Yes, yes, by this you anticipated the principle of modern refrigeration.
Exactly. I am well content to have left behind me my essays and my philosophic writings, to know that my major work, the Novum Organum, released the world from the tyranny of Aristotelian philosophy and paved the way for modern science. My life was full and richly rewarding. I had no cause to wish myself renowned in a métier in which you were supreme, Master Will.
I believe you with all my heart, my lord.
All say. An end to petty quarrels and fruitless bickering. Who writes the play is small import. Who plays it brings to life the art. I, the play's the thing, but a poor thing indeed without the actor.
Burbage.
Burbage? You're Richard Burbage, the first great Shakespearean actor?
Marry that I am, sir. Richard Burbage, star of the Globe Theatre, but more, much more than Burbage. I was Othello, the dusky Moor destroyed by the jealous perfidy of Iago. I was Macbeth the murderer. I was the tortured and tottering Lear, the misunderstood and victimized Shylock. I was the paragon of the pit and the god of the galleries. It was for me that Will Shakespeare wrote his plays. And twere not for me, none of you would be met tonight in this futile discourse. For it was I who gave the name of Shakespeare its first bright luster. Say now, Will, are not the Prince of Denmark's moods but scrawls on paper without the voice of Richard Burbage, for whom they were created?
Far rather would I agree with thee, friend Burbage, than list the vain and maundering arguments of these literary opportunists. Therefore, once more, good friend, speak the speech, I pray you, as I did write it for you.
To be or not to be? That is the question. for that 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing end them. To die, to sleep, no more, and by a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die. To sleep. To sleep. Perchance to dream. Aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death what dreams may come, when we have shuffled off this mortal coil, must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin, who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dream of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose born no traveler returns, puzzles the will and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others we know not of. Thus, conscience does make cowards of us all. And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pith and moment, with this regard their currents turn awry and lose the name of action.
Oh, let there be an end on it, good Dr. Baxter. 'Tis an argument I fear will run a course eternal tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow to the last syllable of recorded time and never find its proper settlement. I say a plague on all their houses.
Come on then, Will. Though we boast no mermaid tavern in Hollywood, there's a quiet little place across the street from the studio where the landlord might well find a stoup of ale or a cup of Rhenish.
Come then, good my friend. Let us tarry here no longer.
They've gone, all of them, back into an ancient past. Our revels now are ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits, and are melted into air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherit, shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep.
You have been listening to an interview with William Shakespeare, featuring Dr. Frank C. Baxter, and produced and directed by William Froug. Our transcribed colloquy was written by William N. Robeson, with additional dialogue by William Shakespeare, Christopher Marlowe, Sir Francis Bacon, and the 17th Earl of Oxford. Additional research by Professor Frank W. Wadsworth of the Department of English, University of California, Los Angeles. Ben Wright was William Shakespeare. Hans Conried was Christopher Marlowe. Ramsey Hill was the Earl of Oxford. Jay Novello was Sir Francis Bacon, and William Conrad was Richard Burbage. This is Hugh Douglas inviting you to listen next week to The Voice of New York, narrated by Clifton Fadiman, a unique venture in giving dramatic form and poetic mood to the actual sounds of New York City, presented on the CBS Radio Workshop. Vera Zorina will narrate three poems of Baudelaire. Isaac Stern will be violin soloist, and Dimitri Metropoulos will conduct the orchestra in works of Glinka, Prokofiev, Lieberman, and Liszt when the New York Philharmonic Symphony offers another brilliant concert this Sunday. Be sure you're listening for the Philharmonic Symphony on Sunday over most of these same stations. America listens most to the CBS Radio Network.
You have been listening to the Old Time Radio Hour broadcast each week over the World Wide Web. You can subscribe at no charge through Apple Podcasts, Podbean, or RSS. And we're now on YouTube. Thank you so much for listening. We hope you can join us again next week for another hour of entertainment from the golden age of radio. Until then, this is your host, Justeen Ward, saying, so long for a while.